afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a pleasure to be here in Dubai. This is my first visit, so I'm really excited to be learning about this wonderful country and experiencing it firsthand. I live and work in Silicon Valley in California and run a global healthcare business in terms of transformation. And in a way, what I do is really help companies prepare for the future. And so many people call me a futurist. I don't really do a lot of stargazing, nor do I do any crystal balls and looking into the sky. What I have is a team of 200 analysts and consultants all over the world that is studying this business, studying the impact of new technologies, doing lots and lots of interviews with people across the world, and coming up with forecasts and predictions. So today, what I'm going to have prepared for you is really paint a picture of what is the future of healthcare going to look like. So I'll give you a 30,000 feet perspective of what the healthcare industry will look like in the future. So we're going to base the future of healthcare. I'm going to refocus that discussion and move to the future of health, because really we're talking about health and not healthcare. For the last 200 years, we've grown a business that is catered to taking care of the sick. And I think we have refocused that now and looking at taking care of the well and predicting and preventing illnesses. So the first thing, the first tenet of this future of healthcare is going to be based on the principle of anytime, anyplace care. And what that really means is that care will be continuous. Today, care is given based on a 10-minute discussion you have with your physician, and your whole the whole year's what you have is based on that one physical that takes place for 10 minutes. And big decisions on your life are taken in those 10 minutes. But what we're looking at is a model where healthcare will be developed continuously with the use of technology. And I see it very similar to the financial services business, where if you look at financial services in the year 2000, you had to wait to go to your bank to make a transaction. You had to stand in line and then fill in paperwork and actually make a transaction with the person or teller. But today, you can bank anytime, anywhere. If you want to take out money at 2 a.m. in the morning, you can drive up to an automatic teller machine. You can bank on your phone. And that is what I really see where healthcare is going to move, where we are going to be at a place of anytime, anyplace care. I think the second big principle that I look at is the whole area of what we call doctorless care. And doctorless care doesn't mean the absence of a doctor. Today, on average across the world, doctors spend about 7 minutes with every patient. And of the 7 minutes they spend about 6 minutes behind a desk or with paperwork, filling out forms or reviewing work. And what's going to happen in future with the use of wearable technology and the Internet of Things and artificial intelligence, doctors will be able to spend the face time that they need with patients for those 7 minutes rather than be hidden behind a computer or a laptop or an iPad. And obviously, this brings into being the whole debate that we are seeing, man versus machine. And this has created a lot of ethical issues. It has created a lot of debate in the United States, where I come from, in terms of how machines will interact with humans or humans interact with machines. And I think it's not a debate of man versus machine. It's a debate of man and machine. Machines will help doctors to do their jobs much better than they could do. And compassionate care will come into place, which is what we're really talking about as the next generation. So why the need to change healthcare today? What are some of the driving forces that we see that are creating this change? The first thing is that the healthcare business globally is completely unsustainable. In the United States, it's about 18% of GDP. It's $3.7 trillion in terms of cost, which is huge. The other factor, if you look at it, is that in 1965, healthcare was 5% of GDP. Today, it's 18%. So if you take the average cost of healthcare in 1960, it was about $147 per person. But today, that has gone up to more than $10,000, which makes no sense because it's not going in terms of the base of GDP. If you relate that to, say, how much you bought a car, in 1965, you bought a car for $2,600. And if we take the same price of healthcare increasing between 1960 today to today, it would be $180,000 for the price of a car. And we know that's not the price of a car. So something is wrong in what we are doing. I think the second big thing is that there's a huge gap in terms of treatment and diagnosis. There's a gap in accuracy. 40% of all diagnostic tests that are done have to be repeated. 60% of drugs that are prescribed lead to some kind of side effects or hospital readmissions. So something is seriously wrong in this picture because we are not personalizing it to the person that we are giving the drug or doing the diagnostic test to. The third big thing that we find in healthcare is that even though healthcare is a science, it's based on scientific facts and principles, less than 50% of healthcare is evidence-based. The rest of the 50% is actually based on gut feel, the surgeon's experience or the doctor's experience over time, and clinical studies. That's all. So it's really a discipline that's not as accurate as we want it to be. The fourth big factor that is driving healthcare is obviously the aging population. We're looking at 25% of the population being over 65 years of age in the next 5 to 7 years. Japan is already facing that epidemic. So that means, based on the 80-20 rule, 20% of the population is bearing 80% of healthcare costs, which means really that we have to look at where the money is being spent, which is on the aging population. And the last factor that we see is that obviously there's a huge disconnect between outcomes. And some of this is being looked at and reviewed based on the new models of value-based care that we're looking at. So in my belief, I don't think the problem is in terms of technology. I think today we have a lot of technology. I think the challenge today is on productivity, making the healthcare system much more productive. 60% of hospital costs in the United States comes from administrative waste, and we're really looking at a system for how we can make the system much more productive. And in my view, data and machine learning can definitely help by creating the algorithms and the systems by which doctors can do their jobs much more easily and seamlessly. So what is the digital revolution in healthcare that we're talking about? Just some simple numbers that I came up with. We're close to 40 million people who are using smartphones today. There's 75% of consumers want to use some form of a digital technology for healthcare practices. Healthcare data is doubling every 24 months. So what you learn in the first year of medical school, by the third year, that data has doubled and as well as changed. If you look at chronic diseases like diabetes, cholesterol, high blood pressure, $47 trillion will be spent by the year 2025. That's a huge amount. We're seeing 20 to 30 billion connected devices in the world. And the biggest change that we see happening is that we've come to the conclusion that 55% of decisions are not focused on the body. They're focused on where you live. So your health eventually is your zip code, which is what we are calling the social and economic determinants of health. And yesterday I was reading that Kaiser Permanente, which is one of the largest health organizations in California where I live, has started investing in property. And they're starting to build real estate for homeless people because they feel that they're having a huge portion of their people visiting the emergency room are people who are homeless or who are having one chronic condition because of the loneliness that they're facing. So we have an HMO in the country building housing now, and that again goes back to the social and economic determinants of health. So obviously there's a huge need for efficient and high quality healthcare. So we have to reverse the debate. All of this time we were spending dollars and money in terms of an aging population. So just so that you have an idea, we're looking at some numbers which are huge here in the bar graph, 22 to 25% that are going to get to the age of 65. There are 10,000 seniors every single day in the United States. And in Japan, we're looking at 70,000. So that is a huge number in terms of cost that's going to escalate into the healthcare industry. So we have to look at changing the cost curve. Rather than focusing on people who are sick and end of life, we need to focus the dollars and spending on wellness, keeping people well. So we did an analysis within our group at Frost & Sullivan with projections of where we believe money is going to be spent in the future. So if you look at the bar graph, you'll be able to see that we looked at three spaces of time, and we looked at therapeutics, we looked at monitoring, we looked at prevention and diagnostics. And right now, you can see in the light green, most of the money is being spent on drugs and devices. But in the future, more and more money is going to be invested in diagnostics, in monitoring, and eventually in prevention. So I always tell this to many of our companies that we work with, that if you're purely focused as a pharma company on drugs or a medical device company on devices, you really have to think beyond a drug or a device, because the model today, the business model, is much more going beyond that to other areas in the ecosystem, which is prevention, wellness, and healthy living. What is the transition of care delivery going to be? So from a provider perspective, we are really looking at moving the model from disjointed care, which is episodic care, that is when you get sick, you see a doctor, you come into the radar, you get well, you leave the radar, to a continuous coordinated care model. We're also looking at a model where rather than having discrete interactions, it's going to be coordinated, and eventually it's going to be location agnostic. As I said, anywhere, anytime. It does not have to be based on a hospital. And really, we are going to go into a virtual world where most care is going to be outside a hospital. And I know the earliest panelists talked about the future of hospitals, and in our belief, the hospital is eventually going to become an ICU of the future, where they're really going to treat intensive care patients, and everything else is going to be around the community, around your home, and maybe even in retail stores and shopping malls. From a patient perspective, obviously, care is going to be, information is coming from a variety of sources. All this time, information was coming from your doctor to yourself, but now, the patient is much more empowered, and there's information coming from very many sources. Second of all, we're looking at medicine moving from generalized medicine, which is one size fit all, to personalized medicine. It's based on my genomic sequencing. It's based on my food habits, how many hours I sleep, what air I breathe. It's based on a lot of social determinants of health, which is personal to me. And the last factor is that obviously healthcare was very reactive. You got sick and then you got a drug to get better. But here we're really talking about products and solutions that will help us be well longer so that we don't have to get sick. So where the dollars will be spent more in the future is in keeping people well, not keeping people sick. So I'm going to talk a little bit about where the technologies are going in the future. So one of the things we do in Frost & Sullivan is we do an exercise every year where we look at the top 50 technologies in the world. And we do that in every sector of business that we cover. And this is what came out of that. And we provide a maturation and timeline technology based on where different technologies are and when they're going to come to fruition. So I'm not going to go into a lot of depth because I only have 5 minutes to finish this. But this figure will give you an idea of where the technologies are today in terms of actually being in the market and where in the future the investments are going to be in terms of growth opportunities. I also want to spend a few minutes talking about the Internet of Medical Things and how that is going to extend from the hospital to the home. And really the purpose of IOMT is really to be able to track, to predict, to stratify, and classify a lot of data that is coming from on the body, from the home, the hospital, the community, and the clinic, and being able to take all of that data, and these are some examples of data sources today that we are getting that are coming to put it together to create a story. And And moving on, I want to just talk quickly about precision medicine as a final parting note, because I think there's been so much of talk on precision medicine. In my view, precision medicine is very simple. It's delivering the right product to the right person at the right time through the right channel. And what we did is we did an exercise to find out today how precision medicine is being practiced and what the future of precision medicine looks like. So even though this diagram looks a little complicated, I'm just going to explain it quickly to you. So if you look, there are four quadrants in this diagram, 1, 2, 3, 4. And what it really shows is the percentage of data sources that are being used or going to be used in the future to make a diagnosis for a particular patient. So in the future, 15% of data sources is actually going to come from just the visit that a patient makes to see a doctor. So from the medical record, from the qualitative discussion that the patient has with the doctor, from looking at imaging, which is almost 90% today of what healthcare is practiced in terms of making a diagnosis. That's going to come down to 15%. 20%, if you look at quadrant 3, is going to come from wearable technology, which is where a lot of work is going on. But the other two areas, which is almost 65%, is what work has not even been started in terms of actually providing data. 30% is going to come from all the omics and the genomics data. And another 35% is going to come from social and economic data. But if you look at quadrant 4, in this space, very few healthcare companies are operating, because this is usually data where you live, what you buy, what you eat, what your education level is, how much you drive, what air quality you live in. And that data is actually being collected by companies like Facebook, Google, Amazon, et cetera. So they are going to play a much more bigger role in healthcare in the future, because they're already collecting this data and using this data now to make predictions on people's health. And this is where the model of healthcare is going to change. So I want to spend a few minutes talking about where the jobs in healthcare will be. One of the things we do is to be able to predict what the future of jobs are going to look like in any market. So obviously, as you can see, in terms of the technology and technicians and information communication, there's a lot of jobs that are going to be focused, like, for example, the healthcare data scientist, the deep learning expert, the quantification designer. So some very, very interesting jobs we've come through. Then there are jobs that we've looked at in terms of medical specialties. For example, a nanomedical engineer, an augmented and virtual reality surgery planner. So very, very interesting positions that we're looking at. And I work very closely with Stanford Medicine, which is very close to where I live. And we actually did this exercise with Stanford Medicine because they wanted to be able to provide the tools and training for their medical students in terms of where the future of these jobs are going to be. And we spent time building this for them, and they haven't even started building curriculums of this except for data science. But in the future, this is where the future is of medical schools and where the different jobs could be. One of the jobs I found very, very interesting is end-of-life therapist. I think that's such an important job, and right now there isn't anyone who really focuses on doing this. And then lastly, we look at jobs in terms of health advisors and looking at watching out for jobs in terms of biologic and genetic terrorists and health data hackers, which is a big area as well. So this gives you a little bit about where the future of healthcare is going and where the growth opportunities are for companies to participate in this new ecosystem. So I want to leave by talking about what does the H in healthcare stand for. So in the last decade, the H in healthcare stood for a lot of hope. And during this time, costs were down, were low, technology was very low. I'm talking of the 1980s and 1990s before 2000. And access was low. And this current decade, the decade of 2000 to 2020, we're really looking at a decade of healthcare hype. There's a lot of technology, the costs are very, very high, and access is still very, very low. And really in the future, we're looking at what we call the H standing for humanism, where the costs will come down, the technology will be very high, but access will also be very high. And humanism is based on compassionate care. It's based on doctors, what they went to medical school to do is just to provide that care and not be buried under administrative waste. So really, the next decade of healthcare, the H is going to stand for humanism. So just quickly about Frost and Sullivan, we have expertise in five big areas within healthcare. We track all of these markets from digital health, medical imaging, pharma 2.0, advanced medical technology and clinical diagnostics, and we have a lot of content, products, services, and analysts that track these industries. So if anyone is interested in any of these areas, I'll be happy to talk about this. So if there's any further questions, I'm always available to talk, and I thank you so much for attending this session.